This is Adventist World Radio Ghana.
Voice of Hope.
AWR Ghana. Voice of Hope.
This is Daylight Magazine, and under this segment, we have Reflections,
Youth Corner,
and Moment of Truth.
I am Kwejo Ansedu, and I'm presenting this with
Hannah B. Nyakun.
How are you doing today, Hannah?
I'm doing well, and you?
I'm doing well as well. I hope, dear listener, you enjoy our programs. Stay tuned.
AWR Ghana, Voice of Hope.
Voice of Hope.
Rejoice in the Lord of my life.
Oh, yeah. People need shelter when Satan starts his show. But I've got a God who can handle anything it throws.
I can rejoice in the Lord. Praises of our King.
I know voices can release the heart when you hear His people sing.
I can rejoice.
Oh yes, you can. Of mercy are still in my heart. Well, you know I may stumble, but I still have the joy of knowing His forgiveness is what sets me apart from the world. It's searching for peace and honest love. I'm glad the Holy Spirit's here to help me through this.
I can rejoice in the Lord.
Facing them all alone, I must keep the Lord in full control. Always speak of my
own. I can
rejoice
in the Lord.
When the night is long and lonely,
He's the one y'all.
Oh, do you have a mirror image? I hope you do. Come join me as we take a purposeful contemplation of our lives. This is the program Reflection.
Hello, listener. Our devotion for today is entitled, He is Risen. He is not here, but is risen. Remember how He spake unto you when He was yet in Galilee, saying, The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and the third day rise again. Luke 24, verse 6 and 7. The Sabbath was past, and Mary Magdalene came early in the morning, when it was yet dark, unto the sepulchre. Other women were to meet her there, but Mary was the first at the sepulchre. They had prepared the sweet spices to anoint the body of their Lord. The women were greatly terrified and buried their faces in the earth, for the sight of the angels was more than they could endure. The angels were compelled to hide their glory yet more decidedly before they could converse with the woman. The woman trembled with awe. The angel said, Fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. He is not here, for He is risen, as He said. Come, see the place where the Lord lay. There was no more weeping for Mary. Her heart was filled with joy and rejoicing. While Mary was absent, He, Christ, appeared to the woman who had come to the sepulchre from another direction. Go quickly and tell His disciples that He is risen from the dead. And behold, He goeth before you into Galilee. There shall ye see Him. As yet there had been no revelation of Christ to the 11, and the woman went to tell the disciples the wondrous news. Thus, Christ made an appointment for a public meeting with his followers in Galilee. Who was it that reminded the woman who was seeking Christ in the tomb of what the Savior had said to them previously? It was Christ who had risen, as he had told them he would. In this connection, Mark gives a most precious statement that must not be overlooked. The angel said to the woman, "Go your way, tell his disciples and Peter that he goeth before you into Galilee." What a comforting message was thus given to the woman to give to Peter. The last look Jesus had given Peter was after the disciples' thrice repeated denial. Peter was not forgotten by Christ, and this mention of his name signified to him that he was forgiven. The wonderful instruction that Christ had given his disciples was never to lose its force, but they had to be reminded of the lessons that Christ had repeatedly given them while he was yet with them. "Remember," said the angel, "how he spake unto you when he was yet in Galilee, saying, The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men, and be crucified, and the third day rise again." The disciples were surprised that they had not thought of these things before. Our devotion was written by Ellen J. White, and my name is Lois Amachimafo.
This segment is about the youth and their lives in today's world. The program is Youth Corner.
Aimlessly beneath the barren sky, leave it to me, I'll lead you home. So afraid that you will not be found, it won't be long before your sun goes down. Just leave it to me, I'll lead you home.
Hello listener, you are welcome to the program Youth Corner. Once again, today we have Mr. Godwin Dabido, a teacher by profession. It was really nice having him on our show the last time, and he's back to talk to us more about teaching as a profession and how good it is. Mr. Godwin Dabido, you are welcome once again.
Thank you, Joshua.
Well, the last time we were talking about teaching being a career, and we were saying a lot about teaching, and I think I was really impressed. Well, I want to go back to this question because I really wasn't clear about it. Because some time back I was talking to a teacher, and she told me she was not happy about her occupation, and she never would allow any of her children be teachers. What do you think about what she said?
She should have her reason. I'll say it's rather unfortunate that a teacher will say that. Her reason could be varied. Let me guess one. Probably she was at a point where she needed money to take her very sick child to the hospital. And she couldn't just get, not from even her friends. She might be in town. It started to rain. She had no money and had to walk through the rain whilst colleagues were going by taxis. These are situations that could make you sit back and ask yourself, am I in the right profession? Scenarios like this could make the faint-hearted actually fall alongside. But I think it was an unfortunate statement.
I also think so. But we come to a point in life where right now most of the things we do or see is you have to get them through money. And she was also saying salaries being paid was not enough. So she doesn't see the reason why she should allow her children to also become teachers. And I also think teaching has taking a negative turn in the sense that you teach these same young ones and 10 to 15 years to come, you see them having big positions and you look back and say, I thought this one and he has made it. How about me? What do you think about that?
Joshua, the problem is that we have an educational system crisis. Why do I say that? Now, we are having people of today who focus on material gain. That is where we all went wrong, as a nation. As a profession, I believe that teachers are supposed to reverse that kind of thinking. Thinking, maladie, sickness of how we perceive things. Seriously. Because some time back, a teacher was not held in high esteem due to the amount of money or material possession, that, but just the knowledge. We see teachers as being very knowledgeable. They were always chiefs and kings in the villages. Teachers were chairmen or chairpersons of whatever big meetings there are in the village or town. Teachers were consulted on developmental issues. We don't see that happening anymore. Why? Because we have shifted focus. And that is what's making the relevance of the teacher also look the way it is now.
Okay. So let me ask you, do you have plans of changing your career?
Why should I? Jesus Christ settled problems. He was not called a lawyer. Jesus Christ healed the sick. He was not called a doctor. Did Jesus Christ even go to the classroom actually to teach? Not the classroom per se. So why was he called a teacher out of all the other professions that he could have been called by? There must be something unique about that.
So if, with all your educational qualifications, you are called by a big company to come and work, you will not leave the classroom. Is that what you're trying to put across?
That is interesting. Just I believe that I could work somewhere else and teach if I get that opportunity. But to leave teaching completely is something I cannot imagine.
So do you have anything doing apart from teaching?
Now I'm into full-time teaching. Probably in the future I might add one or two businesses and a reason to make some money. But that is not the aim. My aim is to always be happy, and you can acquire that just by being a teacher.
So how do you see teaching as a career 10 years from now?
Interestingly, we're going to see a shift where a lot of the young ones in the profession will move out of it completely or will be doing something alongside. That, unfortunately, is what is happening. That is why we have the caliber of students coming out not to be as we want them to. Why do we complain that standard is falling? It's because teachers are no longer dedicated to their work. Why are they not dedicated? They are chasing after the material things that money could buy, which unfortunately the service is not paying enough of to teachers.
Okay. Okay, so the way I see things, if in future you get married, I would like to know, would you allow your children to become teachers?
I would love to say I would like them to be. However, they'll have the decisions to make by themselves. I will encourage them to pursue ever careers they would like to. However, I see one of them becoming a teacher in that my life might be exemplary enough to convince one of them too.
To say, my dad is a teacher, so I would also like to become a teacher.
That is it.
Wow. So tell me, is there anything you would like to say to upcoming graduates who would like to be teachers or who would want to be teachers?
Yes, let me start from the policymakers, the educators, before I come to the graduates. Joshua, we have a system where we copy blindly. We have Ghanaian schools, especially schools that offer business courses, insisting that all business students should wear shirts with tie and suits to the lecture halls. When this happens, they come out of school as graduates and do not want to go to areas where their services are needed. they want to go to offices where they always wear tie, not to go to the construction site to do accounting, not to go to the market store where it's hot to do accounting, because over there they wouldn't dress the way they were taught to dress. Why should we wear tie and coat in this hot weather? It's not appropriate.
No.
Our engineers have the same problem. They want to be in tie, so their vehicles break down by the roadside and they cannot fix it. They go for those we call fitters by the roadside to come and fix it for them.
Yeah.
The problem is with the system. So if the system is made to work properly, then we will see the relevance of teaching. A lot of youth wouldn't be advised to enter the teaching profession. They will long to enter the teaching profession, Joshua.
Wow. Mr. Godwin Davido, thank you very much. Well, listener, it has been nice having Mr. Godwin Davido on the program, a teacher by profession. Thanks for joining us, and we are grateful. I'm your host, Joshua Parkofi Hackman. Thank you so much.
World Radio Ghana.
Voice of Hope.
AWR, Voice of Hope. We will bring you joy. Keep hope alive.
You can contact us on
Adventist World Radio Ghana, Valley View University, P.O. Box AF 595, Adenta, Accra, Ghana, West Africa. Or if you have access to the internet, please send us an email through awr@vvu.edu.gh. Or better still, you can call us on 030-7051-058. The number again, 030-7051-058.
To an aged man God spoke words that sounded like a joke. Soon his wife would bear a child, a saying hard to reconcile. So we ask, can this thing be? Can a nation spring from me? With a body grown so old, in a word this man was told, your life. Mighty things the Lord would do.
Cherished listener, this is the moment of truth, where truth is presented with precision and exactness. Enjoy this encounter of a lifetime.
Calling for you and for me.
Calling for you
mercy on the portals. He's waiting and watching, watching for you. And
welcome
for
to
me.
The Moment of Truth. I'm your presenter, Charles. At this time, I would like us to listen to this very important topic that is captioned Elijah Sustained by God. Elijah Sustained by God. The text of this message is taken from Matthew chapter 6 verse 31. Matthew chapter 6 verse 31. Therefore, do not worry, saying, what shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? Brethren, as it has been quoted, the Lord God of Israel lives before whom I stand. There shall not be dew nor rain those years except at my word. This was a pronouncement made by Elijah in the era of King Ahab. Because of the numerous sins, God instructed Elijah to deliver this message to his people. And right then, Elijah, who has been the pronouncer of this message, also exercised some kind of fear. That is, there will be no food and all the water bodies will be dried up. How is he going to live? God asked him to leave where he is to the Jordan River, precisely the brook of Cherith. Elijah left, and then not quite long, because what he has prophesied has come to fulfillment. The famine was severe, so he could not stand it. But because God knew that he was going to sustain him for all the good things that he's been doing, God asked him to leave from the Cherith near the Jordan River to where he will be sustained. And so he left to a widow who is to take care of him. The story went on and on and on, and at a point where it became so devastating, he got to the woman, and the woman told him about her plight as well, that he has nothing but just a bean of flour and a little oil in her jar. Her family will be taken, and that will be the end of their life. Elijah initially asked water, and he was given, and then from there, he required from the woman a dough for him to take. This woman did as Elijah required from her. She made it and gave it to Elijah, and he was well fed. And right from that moment, the flour that was left kept increasing, and the oil remaining in the jar kept increasing. And this is how God can sustain man if only we believe in him. But sad to say, the devil also came in to disrupt the goodness of God. That is, he struck the sun and he came dead. But the man of God, who is so puffed up in the spirit of the Lord, also required from the woman that he should bring the son. She brought the son, and he took him where he was residing and prayed, laid himself three times on the child, and then prayed to God fervently. At the end of the day, the child revived and he became alive. This is the essence of faith, that when we exercise in the Lord, and when the Lord sees how fervent we are, he becomes so close to us and proves himself on what we have asked. Elijah did it. You equally out there can do so. What is your plight? What is your problem? What are the difficulties you are encountering? Why are you feeling that you are left with nothing? Why are you saying that there's nothing for you to go to church? You have nothing to wear to church, or you have nothing to eat. My brother, my sister, God is always your provider. He will provide whatever you need at every time and every moment. Just trust in him. Be faithful as Elijah was faithful to him, and you have it easy and quiet. I pray that, my brother, my sister, you should look up to God from the Bible and pray over it. Ask God, and God will direct your life, and you shall not remain the same. You become a changed person. You become a faithful son of God or daughter of God, and you will see the Spirit of the Lord in your life. The Lord bless you. The Lord keep you and strengthen you as you continue to listen. Father, we are so grateful for this moment. Your message has come. May you direct it as it is and as you want it to be, so that it will have an impact in the life of my brother or sister out there. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
This is our address, Adventist World Radio Ghana, Valley View University, P.O. Box AF 595, Adenta, Accra, Ghana, West Africa. Or if you have access to the internet, please send us an email through awr@vvu.edu.gh. Or better still, you can call us on 030-7051-058. The number again, 030-7051-058. I am blessed being a part of this program. Hannah, what about you?
The same here.
So I believe, listener, you did too. This has been once again Kwejo Ansendu and
Hannah B. Nyaku.
God bless you.